I'd like to open the Deerfield Planning Board meeting for January 6, 2020. 7 o'clock, Deerfield Town Hall. Our agenda tonight is to look at, potentially look at minutes of a previous meeting, to review some mail, to take some public comment. And then we have a public hearing scheduled, Old Frontier 3 Solar Project on Set Right Road. For revisions to the site plan review, the applicant proposes moving the driveway and interconnect point. Then we'll take up some old business, which is our ongoing discussion and review of the marijuana, new proposed marijuana bylaws. Any other business not reasonably anticipated, including committees that planning board members that we should be on. And then we'll set a date for the next meeting and we'll adjourn. Any questions about that agenda? All right. And you don't all have it in front of you?
No, but it's coming.
Okay, because I think I might have missed some. I think we might have changed the order after, but this is the one that was posted as of last Friday.
Okay.
All right. So the minutes that we have are, did everybody get minutes?
Nope. Just copying.
Yes, I got them.
They're on, well, we have
got them.
They're
on email.
They're on email here.
Right. And so the other thing is, let's just talk quickly procedurally about minutes. So Paul's been doing minutes and doing a good job, and we get behind, but then we catch up usually, and we get pretty good minutes. But now we might have another method to do that.
Well, that's good.
Thanks.
Were you going to do the minutes? Were you going to do the minutes?
Oh, this is transcribed.
Yeah. Thank you.
So we're still kind of talking about how to best do the minutes, but I guess it's, I mean, I take notes sometimes, so I think all of us take some notes so that we know when the minutes come. Sounds minutes are going to be like summary, and they might have something or might not have something that we want. So I think everybody's kind of responsible to make sure what they want in the minutes is there.
Okay. Sounds good.
And we are very appreciative of Sue being with us in the what do we call it, the zoning enforcement or zoning? All right. So thanks very much, and we'll work on our procedures and stuff as we move forward here. So we have some minutes from December 9th. If we want to look at them, because some of them are going to actually pertain to tonight's discussion. So.
So, okay. So So a lot of what we did was go through the changes to the document that Chris gave us tonight. And those are my notes reflect that. It's hard to follow in this, but I get it. That we were pretty.
All right. Well, I guess I'm not totally comfortable voting to put these into the record, because there's a lot in here.
And?
There's a lot in there?
Well, it's basically the whole conversation, and I'm not sure.
Not the whole conversation.
Well, it's a lot of the conversation.
Exactly.
So what's wrong with that?
Because I haven't had time to actually read it. So that's another point, and I think we should, I think we should read it and understand it before we vote on it. So have you, do you feel like this is a good reflection of the minutes? I mean, if enough people want to, I'm just saying for myself, I'm not sure.
Well, did you have a chance to read it before tonight or no?
No, I skimmed it and then I just skimmed it again, but it's, and then I'm not sure what this discussion of the last page.
Actually, when I read it at home last week, I thought it was good, but I thought there were some incidental things that were missing, but it got to the gist of everything, so I was satisfied.
Who else was here? Me, Roger.
This one I looked at.
Rachel, Anne Marie. You guys?
And Mary.
Sorry. I'm so careful on paper, too. Do you want to... How do you want to vote on these?
I would feel comfortable voting on these.
You would?
I read them. Yeah, I took my time. I had a little bit
good.
Of time
okay.
to do
that's
it.
Good. Okay, that's great then. So if there's enough people, yeah. So let's, if someone wants to make a motion in a second, let's do
that. I'll come make a motion to accept the minutes of December 9th.
I second it.
I think we just make the change for Harris is really Curtis. I believe it's Chris Curtis.
Yes.
So I'm not sure that got messed up somewhere along the way, but it is Chris Curtis. So I think we just change all the Harris's to.
That's what I thought, but I said.
Well, it was fixed somewhere.
That's C-U-R-T-I-S. Well,
it's fixed on something.
That's well, I think it was somewhere. Yeah, it was lost in translation. Any other discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Fixed on my
copy.
Abstain.
All right, so we got a 5-1-1. Or
somebody was against
them. No, one's not here, so it's 5-0-1. So you can take.
So
you taking minutes?
Are you taking minutes now? Should I take? Tape?
Oh, you'll look at the video afterwards. Okay. But anytime we vote on something, I think we should just make it clear, like say it 2 or 3 times. That way it makes it easier. All right, we can come back to the mail. Does anybody have any quick, anybody in the public have any quick questions or comments that aren't on the agenda tonight that we can just deal with really quickly?
Can I have a minute?
Sure, if it's not on the agenda.
Well, it has to do with marijuana bylaws. But
it's on the agenda.
I'd like to, this is just a simple matter, but as you know, we submitted proposed bylaws a couple months ago to the selectmen they sent to you with a request that you hold a public hearing. And I'm here just tonight to repeat that request that you hold a public hearing. I'm not asking you to support the bylaws, to approve them, or scrutinize them if you don't want to, but just hold a public hearing, which is what we're entitled to as a matter of law. And it seems like you've just been putting this off and ignoring us. So that's my request tonight. Could you just schedule a public hearing, please, for February, I would ask? And then you know, you can make your recommendations one way or another, and it goes to town meeting.
Excellent. So it's Attorney Dick Evans requesting that we schedule a public hearing. A public hearing for the marijuana bylaws.
Yes.
Thank you. Noted.
Could I ask the board to respond as to whether that's proposed?
So I would say that it's on the, it's going to come up later in the meeting, and based on the discussion we have and the review of the proposed bylaw that we have, then we will schedule a public hearing.
Will you schedule a public hearing on our proposal as well?
That's a good question.
That's my question, yes.
May I ask it? Are you suggesting that we have a public hearing on your proposal versus?
Yes, that's what the statute requires.
On your proposal?
Yes, in any proposal, yeah. That's section 5, chapter 48, which I've discussed here several times.
So if we have a public hearing and the public comes here, he could present his side, and when they ask us, we have no idea what it is.
Sorry?
And then we would respond, we have no idea, because we're working on one for the town.
Well, you could, if you haven't read mine, you could do that.
Well, we read it and then back incorporated into the ones that we're working on. I thought we kind of had an understanding, but I think now.
I've never seen two different drafts of a thing other than people discussing them and coming out with one from it.
Well.
Sounds like you want to have two separate ones.
I want you to hold a public hearing.
Yeah, I know, but I'm saying, I've never seen us discuss two different bylaws. We discuss one and change it if it needs to be. That's my memory of how things go here, but.
I doubt if you've ever been faced with this situation.
He was going to propose, regulations and stuff, and we're going to review it and maybe include some of his ideas into the one that we're creating. It wasn't like we're just going to accept his. That's what I remember.
And that's the process that we've taken, and then Chris has done that. He's taken a lot of what you said, and he actually says a lot of it was good.
Well, I'm not accepting, well, I appreciate that, that you incorporated some of it. But think of this in isolation. I mean, the law says that bylaws can be changed by submitting them to the select board. The select board submits them to the planning board. The planning board holds a public hearing. The planning board then decides whether to recommend or not recommend to town meeting. Then it goes to town meeting, and town meeting votes on the bylaw. That's the process that I'm asking you to respect. Now, if you wish to have another process in parallel to that, that's fine. But please don't just simply ignore the process that we've tried to put in work, put in place, and which we've attempted to comply 100% with the law. We've been fully transparent, but you haven't scheduled a public hearing yet. That's all I'm asking. Schedule a public hearing pursuant to section 5.
So you're not asking for two separate hearings?
Yeah.
No, if you want to have a public hearing on your proposal, that's fine. If you want to do it at the same time as one on ours, that's fine too. That would make sense. But just don't deny us the public hearing that we're entitled to on our proposal. That's all I'm asking.
And just remind me, the standing that you had, because there is laws about who can submit them and how many signatures you need, or da, da, da. And so you're not a resident of Deerfield, I don't believe.
No, the proposal came from the owner, the landowner, 198 Mill Village Road.
Which is Gogrets.
Gogrets, that's right.
As I remember, you offered to help us through this process.
Yes.
And it wasn't from the landowner, it was from you.
Yeah, that's the way.
That's the way I remember.
Item number
six on our agenda is discussion of marijuana bylaws, at which time we could set a time for an open meeting. Is that what you're really looking for?
No.
Okay.
I assume by the marijuana bylaw discussion on your agenda, you're referring to the bylaws that are in the works that you're developing. It's fine. I'm here tonight just to ask you to comply with the statute, which is to set our proposal for a public hearing. Okay. It's a simple matter.
Maybe you should get up at number six and say, we'd like to have a date set and do this. You're starting off with something that's already on the agenda instead of something that's not on the agenda. See what I mean?
Well, our proposal is not on the agenda. I think yours is on the agenda. But it's a simple request on my part.
So you're acting on behalf of Gogrets?
Of course. Everything I do is on behalf of somebody.
Yeah. Right. Well, I'll be frank, that I don't feel like that has been completely transparent. When you offered that previously, and it was very, you're offering your expertise. I've looked around. I've worked with so many towns on this. So I have to say that, and I don't, I say this just like in terms of statute that you're talking about, when somebody just says, here's a great idea, you should look at this, that's the way I took it. So I don't mean to be disrespectful to GoGrids and turning my back on a town.
But you saw my letter.
Entity.
I'm sure you saw my letter of transmittal, which said, on behalf of GoGrids, I hereby propose. Yeah. Everything I've done has been on behalf of one client or another. In this case, it's GoGrids.
And they haven't come before us, and there's nothing, but it's all through you.
We've got three or four people here tonight.
Tonight, yeah.
And I would say the fact is, I think the select board did, I'm not sure how formally, but they did pass it on to us. And
yeah.
So, you know.
All right. Schedule a public hearing.
Yep.
Well, yeah, if he's right, we can check with our attorney and see if that process is what it is. Yeah. And if it is, we'll have to have a public hearing.
Yep.
Yeah. All right, thank you.
Yes.
Could I ask when you're going to schedule it?
We're going to, I think, tonight? Discussion, because ideally we might schedule it for that one, and then we could do them both at the same time.
Sure, I think it makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
Do you have any idea when that will be?
When we discuss number six in our agenda.
If it looks close enough to bring to a public hearing, we'll do it next month. Yeah.
Good, all right.
And it might be.
All right, I'll sit here and wait. All right, thank you.
I did miss you at the last meeting.
I appreciate you saying that. It's kind of.
All right, anything else? No. All right, so let's get on to public hearing. I have a public hearing notice here. So this is the notice of public hearing. The Planning Board of the Town of Deerfield will hold a public hearing on January 6, 2019 at 7 p.m. in the main meeting room at the Deerfield Municipal Offices, 8 Conway Street, South Deerfield, for Old Frontier Solar 3 to review revisions to the site plan review. The applicant, based on input from electric company, is proposing changes to the project driveway and interconnection point. The property on Setright Road, map 142, lot 20 and 22, on property owned by Chester Ostrowski. So, if you want to give us a little refresher and then bring us up to speed, I think this will be it.
Now, do we specify we started at a certain time with this meeting?
So this public hearing is starting at 7:20.
7:20.
All right. Good evening, everybody. Scott Reamer with Hexagon Energy, based out of Charlottesville, Virginia. I was here, I think it was November, maybe October, last time we talked. I was hoping to get back in front of you a little bit sooner, but these things have a few moving pieces, so it's taken a little while to get everything between the utility, the landowner, and our internal engineering lined up, but we believe we've been able to do that. For the big contextual process here, the Eversource requested that we move. We had planned originally to run our power lines. I'm going to shift over to the map here quickly, I guess.
You can take it with you as far as you can go.
Let's see. All right, I think this is... Let's see. I think we can make this work here. We had originally planned... This fence line is the solar array fence line where everything is going to sit. That was all approved in a previous set of hearings. Our original plan had been to shoot a buried power line down south and then run along an easement back to Setright Road, which runs here at a corner, and then connect there. Eversource had requested, because of their structure, however they're designed and built, that we keep everything on the same parcel instead of crossing parcels. And so they wanted us to run either one of two ways. We could run the power line across from the northern portion along the northern edge of this property, or along the southern edge. You know, this is an active agricultural field and will remain so we didn't want to run right through the middle of it. Our original plan had been to, I apologize.
I think we have some of the little plans here if anybody wants to look at it.
You can see this a little better right here. Our original plan had been to run along Setright Road right here and run a dirt road along Setright and upgrade. Set right throughout. However, when we started looking at this and took Eversource's recommendation into account, we realized that it would make a lot of sense to run along a southern boundary of the parcel right here and connect. So really we're talking about shifting the driveway and interconnection point about 500 feet south. There is a row of trees right here along this area, as well as a small um, hill that dips down.
Yeah.
In talking previously, the conversation then was, would this count as a minor change that you guys could unilaterally approve, or would this require a public hearing? And we decided, because of some of the conversations we had had previously, that it would be best to get some neighbor engagement and see, because there is a residence right here. Mr. Martino lives there, and actually he and his wife are here this evening. So I did reach out to them and talk with them, and we went through a few different design considerations. And I believe we were able to come to terms that this is, I apologize, this is not that great of a setup here, but it's working. What we agreed to do is bury the power lines the whole way alongside the dirt road. And instead of putting the electrical boxes, which is what will be, instead of mounted on poles, they'll be sitting on like ground-mounted transformer boxes like you see. Instead of putting them here, we were able to move them back about 125 feet. And so they're sitting there. And I believe, I don't want to speak for Mr. Martino, and it's a public hearing, but I believe we've been able to come to terms. I haven't heard any other comments from any other neighbors. You know, we think that this is better for all parties, because rather than having to bring more gravel in to upgrade this whole road,
right,
we avoid all of that.
Right.
And we actually stay well behind. I have a picture here. Granted that this is in the summer, but we want to run the power lines, basically a buried line right alongside this existing berm of trees that is full growth in the summer. So, you know, take that for what it's worth. In the fall, it won't be there, but it's still down at the bottom of a hill. And taking some advice, that's a 6-foot stick that I took right here. And so you can see how tall the trees grow in the middle of the summer. So I'm requesting that the board please approve the shift in the driveway and the interconnection point. One final comment. Previously, 4 power poles were located right here,
right,
at the elbow of Setright Road. Those are no longer there and will no longer be visible. So actually, the overall visibility is decreased.
I went up and drove up and looked at that, and I wondered why you go underground, up 4 poles, and then go back underground and go off.
Yeah.
So they can do it on the ground level then.
Yeah, so there will be a buried power line along the existing spot where there's buried power line.
And so where would those ground units be located?
They're going to be 125 feet back about here on the roadway. So that's the summary. That's it. And any questions for me at this point?
So do you have you submitted new plans?
We have. Yeah, this set got submitted to you guys several weeks back.
Is that what those plans
are? So do you know if any, are they in this box, or are they, do you know if they're here?
Yeah. Where did they go? I said, so they were in the office, they were right here on the public area, and I just grabbed them really quickly to set right here for this presentation.
Okay.
They're not there anymore. I got that.
They're here.
And I'm using them.
This is the old one. This is the old one.
This is the old one. Yeah, that's the old set right here. So you can see this has the northern road right along there.
Mm-hmm.
So what we're doing is that instead. Here.
Would there have been copies made? How many copies would you have submitted?
I remember this.
I am not quite sure.
Go this option before because of the existing road?
Right.
Our reason before was that there is an existing road up along here.
Mm-hmm.
However, further surveying, because we really had to dig into some of that, mm-hmm, a further survey actually showed that road sits off the property line. Actually, it bisects the property line. So we would have had to build more of a driveway, actually, because we wouldn't have even been able to use that road, which was a snafu with the surveyor, and we had to get those lines adjusted properly. So that would have been a lot more gravel being shipped in. But yes, originally we had run that way because there's an existing farm road along the northern edge, and we thought it would be easier. Turns out it wouldn't be.
But there's no road where you're proposing it now.
Not yet.
So you've got to bring in gravel.
Right, for that portion. But rather than having to upgrade, and we would have had to bring gravel in along this road anyway, because it's just dirt right now.
Right.
We would have had to bring gravel in, and we would have had to bring gravel in for this whole stretch right here.
Right.
As is, we only have to bring gravel in this way. And this is, and the landowner does currently use it as a driveway area to access his farm fields in the back.
He doesn't use that other.
He uses both.
Right.
Yeah.
But the other, Jimmy does it, other ways.
I wonder if your plans that you sent, would they be in the planning?
These are that, right here.
These are the ones that they've had looking at.
Oh, just that they had them, if they had a bunch of them made up, you know?
Oh, wait a second.
I have some 11 by 17s that I can indigenize.
Actually.
Here.
Oh, okay.
I was looking at the box. This box is not it.
So it's about 500 feet.
This is for.
You say you have 11 by 17? I'd like one.
It's not this entrance? This is on North Street.
And I can get more copies of the name, but. This is 11 by 17, set.
This is the file that shows that we did the public, to do the public hearing, that it went in the newspaper, and that notice was sent out to abutters. The two will return.
Now, does this show those boxes on the ground, on this 11 by 17?
It's shuttered.
Or is this the boxes back here you're talking about?
No, those are the pads that are sitting, or that's the pad that the worker sits on.
Yep.
Yeah, there you go. Interconnection pads. Right,
okay,
there.
All right.
So that's 125 feet.
Oh, wow, okay, that's 125 feet. Okay, mm-hmm. Yep. All right.
All right, questions? I don't know, open up to the public. Yeah. Anybody would like to comment on this proposed plan? All right, come on up and just tell us your name and you know the drill.
Just briefly, Anthony Martino, I live right
What's
there.
What's that?
Anthony Martino is my name, 39 Set Right Road. Basically in agreement, but I guess, like I told Scott earlier, the 125 feet, I would like that further to put the electricity boxes.
So the
further back towards the array?
Towards, yes, right. Away from the street.
Right.
What's the downside of moving it further away?
Just more design changes and having to get every source to approve it and working with them.
So what happens at the box? Like, who drives there? How often do they do it? Like, what is that box for? Just so we all know.
Yeah, it's a transformer box. So if you drive around, you'll see the
right.
Green transformer boxes. They drive there as needed. It'll typically be somebody will drive out to the array about once a month. So when they drive out once a month, they'll check the box to make sure everything is working properly.
And you would just like them further away from your house?
Yeah, if they're driving out to the array anyway. On the way.
Yeah.
And has it got like a production meter in it or something they got to read? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's got the meter. That's basically what it is
right.
It's the electricity meter where they read what's changed. They, the utilities like to have these right on the road as often as possible.
Right.
So we had to push them a little bit and, you know, beg and ask them to allow it to be this far back. So it's somewhat a matter of convenience, but also I can check a little bit more, but my engineer basically let me know that that's about as much as we were going to get out of them for it.
So in other words, he's getting something on the ground for 125 feet back rather than those four poles
right.
That stick up out of the ground
right.
For that. So it sounds like this is quite a significant reduction
yeah.
Of the eyesore,
nice
isn't it?
And you know why Eversource
that be true
or
anything?
Poles,
right? Yeah, exactly.
What's that?
There was no poles in the original plan. It was for, at the corner.
Yeah.
It was on the other end, is that right?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
That transformer that you speak of, is that about 4.5-5 feet tall?
No, it should be shorter than that, as a matter of fact. I got a picture of, I got a picture. It'll be approximately, the transformer will sit here. This is the meter that we're talking
just
about,
the
smaller, the smaller
yeah.
Meter,
meter
and whatever the interconnection material is. So it'll be a box about
okay.
This,
yeah.
This size,
yeah.
A couple little boxes this size.
And there's already one right on,
yeah.
right around there.
Oh.
Right,
yes,
and that's on that new, that's going to be along that new dirt road that
yeah.
You're constructing,
right.
Which
yeah.
Is
there's,
on the north side of that tree line. Correct?
There's one about here right now,
right.
And these will be right here. On the north side of the tree line, right.
Yeah.
Just out of curiosity, why do they have to go there to read them?
As in what?
Well, I have a set of panels at my house, and I have a production meter there.
Yeah.
Nobody comes and looks at it ever.
Yeah.
It just sits there because it's all done over the telephone.
They won't be coming to read them. They'll just be coming to check and make sure everything's operating. But they'll transmit digitally to the utility to meter it. But they'll just come to check on it and make sure it's operating properly when they do their connection checks at the array.
They'll maintain the access road like mm-hmm. plow in the wintertime. Mm-hmm. So.
Yep.
They will?
The power
company. Yeah, we'll contract with somebody to maintain it.
They do it.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's what I said. Because
sorry,
if they
sorry,
get
sorry,
an engineer to look
not
at
EverSource.
Yeah, right.
Sorry.
Basically, my
point
is, if
125,
why not
200 or 250? Well, my guess is it's an EverSource call. That's the problem.
Yeah. You know, we were at 100 feet initially, and Mr. Martino and I had talked, and I was like, yeah, I agree. Let's see if we can't go a little further back. And EverSource was 125 is doable, and that's where we got to with them.
I mean, does it cause some harm? To you, or I guess I'm not clear what the main issue is.
Well, you've been down many roads, John.
It's just not ideal.
Some of them are disguised, and some of them aren't. They're just an ugly metal box. I can understand where it's going.
But
there was a farm field there prior.
But you won't.
But Mr. Martino did say it's not a non-starter. It's just not ideal.
Right. Yeah. No. I'm not.
Fire. Right.
Yeah. Right.
Right.
Yeah. Submit it to them, see if they'll change it. If they don't, they don't. You know?
Yeah, it'd
yeah.
just be nice
yeah.
if
I think that'd be great.
Get the vote, get a vote on that. So
yeah.
I mean,
all right. Thanks.
My point of view on that, too, is that not only it's 100 something feet away from the road, but it's on the north side of the tree line and it's going to be lower. That
right.
There's a drop in that field. Yeah. There's a possibility that these folks might not even see that box 30 inches tall there.
No, I don't imagine they will, because again,
yeah.
you know. There's a hill here, drops down,
yeah.
the box will be going
okay.
right about
well, that tree line is on someone else's property, so that can vanish any day.
Right, but the
well,
elevation.
I know, the elevation,
right.
yes, that won't
right.
change,
trees.
I don't think.
So
but
half,
it's
of them,
pretty low.
Half of the trees
yeah.
could vanish, half of them won't be. So I'm happy to request with EverSource that they let us move it a little bit further back. I do think that, costs, timing, those all start compounding every time we go through this, so I'd love to be able to basically, we're about ready to start building, I think, early in the next year, so I'd just like to be able to get everything buttoned up. So I don't have a problem with it going further back.
I'd also think that it would be nice, just now we're talking about those trees and that tree line, to put a condition on it that
yeah.
the trees not, whatever trees are on the property line stay there.
Well,
you can't do that. They're on somebody else's property, Rachel.
No,
well,
some
you just
of,
said
some
the
copper
on this property.
Well,
some
is it?
Yeah.
I will say, Mr. I mean, we're only leasing this area, and we have an easement through here. Mr. Ostrowski could. That's beyond kind of our purview. I see he won't clear. I might would have no
all
idea.
So you're not leasing the property.
No, well,
but the
we're
trees
leasing
are on
this property, but we just have an easement with them.
Let's say, for instance, if there happens to be a fire or something out there, where's their access to get out to the transformer units in at the property line? So they're going to come out the same road or come out that new road that you're going to use for the cable?
So you're saying if there's a fire here or here?
Yeah, if that right there, there's the transformers,
uh-huh.
right,
uh-huh.
and the panels. If that's where they might be a problem with this, you need to get the fire department to, correct?
Yeah, if there were ever to be something like that, they'll just cut. Right down the road.
They'll go right down that road? Oh, okay.
Yeah, right. They've got a hammerhead turn here just in case they need to be able to.
Okay, that's what I was asking, whether they
yeah.
whether they have some other road.
Yeah.
But that's a good point. So whatever specifications we had for that other road need to be carried
yeah.
over to this road.
It,
because we
yeah.
made sure that emergency
yeah.
vehicles can go down
yep.
there.
They're
yep.
the same ones. You'll see we've got here, it's 18 foot wide earlier, and then it narrows down to 12, but in any turning area, it's extra wide so that the vehicles are able to handle that easily.
Okay, all right.
So when you're, Rachel, I was thinking we could make a condition that the box is kind of obscured by the current trees, or if someone cut them down, put up a couple bushes.
Sure.
And,
yeah, that's,
and then we do that a lot with them. We do that a lot in other decisions, right?
Yep.
Yep.
Yeah.
Just what do we call it? Just
A point was just made earlier, there's nobody has authority over, you've got two landowners, and this isn't actually the property.
That the road runs down.
So it's an easement?
Yeah. Yeah, and the easement runs through about 35 feet off the property line.
And if they put the shrubs in the, and connect it to the easement so that they cover it, just that, right around the, that box, right?
I mean, it's the whole issue, the public utilities can do whatever.
Little box.
No, but we're talking about
two different landowners.
I know, but he's pointing out that the box is going on the property.
The road is going to be on one landowner's, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
It's going on the landowners, it's not going on the property that they're leasing.
Right.
So it's going across the landowner's property.
But I would think that you could put in the easement that goes down that piece of property, that you put the bushes around that box as part of the easement would also be there.
Arborvitae's right around it, since they're planting some of those there. I mean, the odds of,
If it's in the easement, then it doesn't matter, but they're going to be there. If they're taken out, you've got to replace them, that's all.
Right. Yeah, sure. If you want to say that if the trees are, as a condition, if the trees are removed, that
then you put in some
arborvitae's were replaced around it, that's great.
Yeah, that because that can be written right into the easement, I believe.
Yeah, that's not a problem at all. Does that work for you?
Yeah.
And what was your address?
Prefer that it goes further away.
Put the solar panels, put the boxes right next to the solar panels, and then we're
right.
Yeah, we'll have to have them in the middle of the field.
I mean, that's the whole thing.
And what was your address? I couldn't hear it.
39.
Set right Road. Okay.
Yes.
And do I understand that he's going to try to go from 125 to 200 feet, and either place in that area is fine with you still?
Yeah, I'm not opposed to it. I'm just asking if we can.
Yeah, I'm just saying that.
The further we can put him towards the structure.
Closer to the.
Okay, all right.
Yeah.
Probably the better for that.
Yeah. I'll check and see with Eversource again.
Again, Eversource.
I think that's.
Yep. No problem.
You check back with us and let us know.
Well, it's really Eversource really is going to be the one that's going to,
right.
That they have to talk to. So,
right.
If you guys need to be together on this and be okay with it, if it's not us that's going to say to you.
Right. All I'm requesting is I know that 125 feet works. I might be able to get a little bit more, and I, as a sign of good faith, I definitely will try
that's
to,
okay with you,
to do so.
So this is another case of, like, we got to get our administration together, because I don't have the actual, you submitted another, the plan.
Yeah, these were submitted to the town,
the
set right here.
All right, because we'd like to make a decision, we need to refer to these
plans.
Are
there other sets in the planning office, because
that's what Sue's not
I
sure.
I do have a key to that office.
Is this
this was in the planning office.
This is the one to sign?
Yeah, this is signed stamp.
So this is what was sent to the town?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then this is a duplicate of that smaller size.
Yeah.
So this number on this page here says, does it have a number on it?
Oh, you do have this up here?
He said he had these here. Take a look at that. If that's the same numbers, it should be on there.
Just for decision, we should use this date.
Yeah.
1240. Yeah, so this was. It's from December 20th.
And is there a date on the plans? Besides the date, is there a definition of it? It's just a set right. I mean, the Old Frontier 3 solar project dated 12/20/2019, right?
Updated.
Updated.
Revised 12/20, because it's
updated.
A lot of it didn't need to be revised, you know. So.
Oh, there they are.
Yeah, here they are. On the plate here.
Okay.
Oh. No, these were just the ones that I was.
Yeah, that's the whole complete set.
Yeah, this is the complete set.
All right, so does anybody, so is there any other public comment? Would any other discussion that we want to have during the public hearing? Otherwise, we can have a motion to close the public hearing. Anything else you want to say? Because
no, thank you, guys.
Well, I think we're.
Should we close?
I will move that we close the public hearing.
Second.
Also,
We haven't voted yet, so, okay.
Just last thing. We will work to try to extend this further back, and if that is something that works, just be clear that, it would be helpful for us on our side to be clear that we won't have to come back for,
right,
like,
that's,
everybody
that's what we
to move
yes.
the box.
Put them in the condition.
Yep.
But we'll try to do more, but that it's okay if it's where it is, too. So 125 more. Okay, great. Thank you.
So far as provisions go, it's this moving of the box back to the to that space, right?
So we're in the middle of a vote. So Rachel moved to close the public hearing. Anne Mary seconded.
Yep. Okay.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? So that's 6-0-0.
And right. Rachel made the movement, and Mary Anne Marie got the second.
Anne Mary.
Anne Mary.
Okay.
It's almost been a year. all right. So now, does someone want to make a motion, and then we can sort of list our conditions? So.
Would it be just on the?
On the revision,
Okay, I move to approve the revisions to the old Frontier Solar project off of Set Right Road.
Second.
And the plans dated, was it December 20th, you said?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. 40 small.
And down there it says,
a magnifying
right
glass
there, 1220.
Oh, yeah.
All right, and if we can put in conditions that Old Frontier Solar will try to get, the minimum is 125 feet setback, and they're going to try to get more.
For the meter box,
mm-hmm.
as it's called.
Yeah.
And then the meter box will be covered with shrubberies.
And in the event that the...
It'll be surrounded with them.
No, I think...
If it's necessary. Not moved back further.
In the event of... loss of tree yeah. foliage in that area.
Yeah, that's what I was getting at. That
would be plantings.
Okay.
I guess I could think of green.
Yes, yes. Right.
I think, too, Scott, it would be good if you, whatever the findings are that you have from Eversource, if you would alert the Martinos, I think that would be really...
Sure.
As yeah. And us as well.
Sure.
Thank you.
And that the, and again, maybe just put in here that the road, conditions of the road have to meet previously.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. Agreed upon.
Probably should reference back to the original.
Yeah, the whole thing.
Find that reference back.
Yeah, and it does, I guess, am I allowed to speak?
Sure.
If we ask you a question, so we're going to ask you a question about that road.
Okay, great. It does do away with a lot of the need to upgrade a lot of Set Right Road as it existed. So if it references back to previous rules, just make sure it doesn't, please make sure it doesn't bind us to upgrades sure. to yeah. that portion. That's all.
Right, the part that you're not going
to. That we're not touching any longer.
Okay. All right, that's a motion by Kip. Do we have a second?
Second.
Second by Rachel. Any more discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Oppose? Abstain? 6-0-0.
Thank you very much.
The revision has been approved, so we'll keep that. And so we do need the electronic versions
okay.
as
yeah.
well, which you might have actually sent.
If we haven't, then I'll make sure those are over to you.
And I think there was no other fees because this doesn't...
Yeah.
Actually...
And John, the first
does it require more land disturbance? I guess it's actually the same.
Less.
So, John, just for my benefit, the first one is to close the meeting. The second one is to present the conditions.
It's to approve
the conditions.
It's to approve the revision with those conditions.
Yeah, gotcha. Yes. Okay, so close the meeting.
Thank you. I'll send a digital copy of everything if it's not already sent, but I'll resend it anyway to Sue and whoever's email addresses I have on the board.
Thanks. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. Happy
right,
New Year.
I hope Eversource doesn't throw you anything else at you.
You and me both. You never know.
I don't know what I was going to do, Mary. They tend to do that.
Yes. They don't.
Thank you.
You don't telegraph their play.
New
business. Old business. Ongoing discussion, review of proposed marijuana bylaws, and so we spent a lot of time on this last month. Chris has done some updates, and so if we can hear from you, maybe just quickly the things that we all agreed on, and then if there's any major things that we want to discuss. And I think the goal of tonight is to get this to a point where we can feel comfortable bringing it to a public hearing. It would need a public hearing, and then eventually go to the town. It has to go to a town meeting, and if we, I think if we stay on this target of having a public hearing next month, we could get it to the town meeting in spring. Mm-hmm. So that would be ideal. So. All right. Yes.
So yes, we last time we did go through the text of the bylaw in some level of detail, and I think the primary thing to spend time on tonight would be the actual zoning districts where uses would be allowed or not allowed. But I would like to, I think since Paul wasn't here the last time, maybe just kind of quickly maybe summarize some of the things that we talked about the last time. The model that I've handed out to you, I think everybody has a hard copy of it, reflects the comments that we took in from all of you last time, and also the comment I think that John made, which was that we should go back through the existing marijuana bylaw that you have on the books now, mm-hmm. and make sure that there are any really relevant or key provisions from that existing bylaw should be included in the new one. So there's a few things that got included because of that review, for example, in the definitions section and a couple of other places that I'll point out. All of the changes since the last meeting are in a bold italic font, just so you can find those. And I'll talk about those in just a second.
Now, can I ask you a question, Matt? Dick, do you have a copy of what he's got tonight?
No, I have the original version.
Yeah, probably better if you follow along with us and see if there's anything that you know.
So, just I think maybe for Paul's edification and refresher for everybody else, this. Originated from a model bylaw that was drafted by a group of planners in the Pioneer Valley from Springfield, East Hampton, Belchertown, Cummington, Pioneer Valley Planning Commission, and the Central Mass Regional Planning Commission. So folks with a good degree of expertise and broad cross-section of city and town types. The key sort of recommendations from that group in looking at marijuana bylaws were that they recommend marijuana cultivation be treated as an industrial use as it requires a secure and closed structure. Secondly, that they permit adult use marijuana establishments only in specific commercial or industrial zoning districts. Third, that a town should adopt a limit that is 20% of the town's licenses for alcoholic beverages for the number of adult use establishments, marijuana establishments. And that provision actually is in your existing bylaw.
Yeah.
Yep. Next, that the gross floor area of a marijuana use should be, that is open to the public should be limited to 2,500 square feet. There should be a buffer area around those types of establishments that includes buffers for schools, daycare, and similar types of uses. That adult use marijuana establishments be prohibited proximate to residential uses. That operators should provide a decommissioning bond to the town in the event that the use ceases to operate. And that all applicants should be required to submit to the planning board a provisional license from the state prior to pursuing such a project. So those were some of the kind of core pieces that got put into the bylaw. And then in terms of, you know, what we've changed since the last time, there are two definitions that I added, which came from your existing bylaw, definition for marijuana, and for marijuana social consumption operation.
that second one is relevant because we, the comment was made that we wanted to prohibit those types of uses, so defining them is probably important.
And which ones are they in here, the ones that you had?
I'm sorry?
Where are they in here, the ones that you're...
If you look at the bold italic...
Okay, I'm sorry, yeah, thank you.
That's the new stuff.
I don't want, sorry to interrupt, but before we get too deep into this, so the only changes that you made are the ones that are in italics, correct?
That's correct.
Yeah.
And one of the first... Bolden too, is that true?
Italic and bold is a change.
Okay, yep, thank you.
But the bold that are not italicized, just to be clear, are not changes.
One of the first things that we had some discussion, quite a bit of discussion, was, you know, the definition of the cultivation thing. There's a lot more lumped into this than what we originally planned. And, you know, now we're looking at changing the district out of the RA into these other industrial things off of these models that you speak of. And that I would tend to agree with some of these definitions, but we already have one that's in an RA district. And it was put forth in front of the community to have this to help the town, you know, help farmers and, you know, in the community, and also for the town to generate income. So, you know, we have a current cultivation facility, and if we adopt this language, then it can become more than that. It can become a processing center, a packaging center, and a preparation. So when you use those words, you know, it's going to be very difficult to, you know, people can do a lot of different things with that terminology instead of just farming it and harvesting it. You know, it's kind of like, if it was farming, you know, you grow potatoes, now you have a potato chip factory, you know, that type of thing.
Right. So that, I guess that's part of the issue about deciding which districts you want to allow this type of a use to go forward in. And what you can also do is to restrict different types of marijuana businesses to specific districts. So
I think that's what you're talking about is
right. How do you go back though? That's
well, look, I don't think if I'm correct, we talk about cultivation. What are the different categories in here?
Well, if you look at the easiest place to identify those,
is the next thing, which is different than
if you look at the second to last page, there's a table of use regulations.
Yeah, excellent.
And there are seven different types of marijuana uses there. And
because I just want to just Kip, I think you were talking about it says processing and packaging,
right?
But that's the primary processing, right? That goes with cultivation. Or I don't even know if primary is the right word, but you know, there's the different levels of processing.
Well, if you don't define that, any good lawyer is going to say, you know, putting this in that package, that's packaging. You know, if we're going to turn this into gummy bears, that's processing. It's a process. And, you know.
And there is some other stuff.
But I thought that doesn't the state have, are these state definitions? Or are these, I thought the state, Cannabis Commission has.
Well, these came from the ones that you're seeing that aren't in the italics came from the model bylaw.
Okay.
And I think those in turn, many of them were derived from the state regulations.
And I guess my point, if I'm not being clear, is that I see no problem with that going forward. But if we're going to adjust our bylaws, now this is our bylaw, so any existing facilities say, well, we're complying with the bylaw and this is what we're doing. How do we separate the two? Yeah, I don't think that if we're not careful with this language, I think after the fact we can't say, okay, you can do it here, but now you can't do that there, you know?
You're saying the one that exists.
Exactly.
Right, so each of the terms...
Is what?
You exclude him. He's grandfathered for what was at that given moment when it was established. It was just for growing, not for processing.
I think that would be a difficult thing to try to...
I don't know.
Well, this section 4662 is just definitions of different things. And how do those fit into what we have already? In other words,
well, they don't. None of
they.
Well, Kip, it makes it pretty clear when it says cultivator that process and package, they spell out what processing and packaging is, and it's not about gummy bears. It's processing and trimming and packaging. So,
in this new.
When you say packaging, like for an individual or packaging to send off to a establishment that's going to pack it into ounces or however they do it.
Oh, I misspoke. I'm sorry. This says to dry cure and trim. So packaging is separate.
Yeah.
But
and could I ask, what are you reading from? Are you reading from the new bio? The new
yeah. Post? Yeah. Yeah. Second page in. Definitions.
So Kip, I think the point I was trying to make is if you look at each of the types of uses that are in the table of use regulations at the back, each one of those seven types of uses is defined in the definitions so that you can clearly delineate the difference between a retailer and a cultivator, for example.
And the product manufacturer.
And I get that, but what I'm saying is this new definition is in my mind, expands our current definitions.
For which term?
For cultivations. Because the cultivations that we currently allow are for people to grow it. And yes, of course, they're going to cut it to whatever size and they are going to put it in a box and ship it out. But with this language, you know, where it says, harvesting, processing, and packaging, I think that's a very broad term.
Okay.
So on page 3, it defines process. Harvest, this is what Anne Mary was just saying.
And the next one
harvest,
says...
Harvest, dry, cure, trim, separate parts.
And the next one, the product manufacturer...
that's where you transform it into.
Yeah, right.
Exactly. Something that's confusing to me is in this chart that's the last page here under RA, which is what you guys are under, right? It says no everywhere down through there.
Right.
So how do we deal with
this? This is the discussion we had followed up over the last meeting.
Okay, I'm
sure. Right.
That we wanted to go do the marijuana overlay district, maybe relook at that. Because we've learned over the past 2 years that RA is maybe too expansive. Well, we said special permit there. So we want to pull back a little and actually set up some overlay districts.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. All right. I see. So that's the MO is going to take the place of what we have in the RA now.
Everything in that table is really up for discussion tonight.
Okay.
That's the part get to.
But sorry about that.
But we wanted to pull it, we did want to pull back from our previous one, which was special permit everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
So the intent would be to take the existing and put them in an MO district, overlay district, is that correct?
That's one option, yes.
Yeah, okay, all right. And then the one that's over here in the old plastics area there on Route 510 is the PI district, right?
That's correct.
So those are the only two that we have that?
Yeah.
Okay, gotcha.
Right. That's
gotcha.
Right. So before maybe we go into the discussion about the districts, I just want to make sure that you understand that there are a few other changes that were made, and primarily what you see in the bold and italic are just sections from your pre-existing marijuana bylaw that I added in to make sure that we had complete coverage of all of your existing regulations. And then there were a few minor things that were comments from the last time that you saw reflected in the minutes that are now reflected in the bylaw. I don't know if we need to go through those individually necessarily, but it's up to you.
And you may have discussed this before, but how does the medical and the recreational one fit together? Is this all?
This sort of replaces the two existing bylaws and creates one marijuana bylaw. I guess one point that I would maybe highlight is we talked a little bit about the issue of having a buffer near schools, and there was the question of whether we wanted to expand that language.
What page is that on?
This is on page, sorry that there aren't page numbers, it's page 5, top of page 5.
That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, okay, gotcha.
Where it says in bold italics or licensed daycare center. That was the gist of the discussion that we had last time, that we wanted to have the buffer include not just schools but also daycare centers. So that's that's the language that I'm suggesting. It does not include churches, which we sort of went back and forth about.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't put it in because it seemed like the sense of the board was that that was maybe too much. But we, you know, we can work with that. Whatever,
well, some of this, like the license daycare, isn't that state verbiage too? They want to buffer from that?
It is, yeah.
And is that, because the case we had was, what was that case?
That was with the Atlantic Furniture.
Was it a licensed daycare?
No, it was a family center.
I know, it's like another name.
It was a family daycare.
Was it Tully? Was her name Tully, the lady that ran it?
Well,
it was over there. There's the one behind at 5 and 10 anyways.
But here we just have a definition, there must be a definition of what a licensed daycare center is.
Yeah.
And that's what we go by.
You sure she wasn't licensed? I thought she was.
She did have a license.
Family.
She had a different kind of license.
It was a family.
It was a different, had a different designation. And it is run in a different way, but because she can take older kids and smaller number of kids, it's not. More about the.
This one?
I think it's called family care. Yeah.
And it's a smaller number of kids. It's not
right,
like,
it's like.
It's not like 20 little kids.
Yeah, it's like eight or less, something like that. Yeah.
Operating more kids. So, and I think that is an industry that's going to have to catch up with. Like, we were worried that she's going to. What her regulations are going to be, because they don't have regulations for this city, but that wasn't my concern at the time.
Oh, they might not be able to move in next door.
So she should be, right.
But anyway, I mean,
she should be fine now, but the next person may not get a family daycare license if it's in proximity. I don't know,
right.
But that's going to be the family daycare
right.
Mm-hmm.
Decision of ours or the regulators of that industry.
So there were some things in your existing bylaw, for example, about the hours of operation that. Are now included here. We talked about discussion about having the police department engaged with the review of security measures. That's included here now.
This is on the dispensary one here on page 5?
Yes, exactly.
Now, if I remember the time before you we were here, Dick, you guys wanted to have a kitchen in your thing, or did that, was that something that fell into this?
Well, we wanted to do product manufacturing, what was called product operation, and our bylaw, and that would include something in the nature of a commercial kitchen.
I didn't hear anything you said. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I was answering Paul's question. In our draft of the bylaw, we refer to product manufacturer, which is the term in the regulation, the state reg, but we call it product preparation. And it does contemplate product preparation or manufacture, whichever term you use, does contemplate something in the nature of a commercial kitchen. In other words, making gummies, making gummy bears.
Yep.
So
this looks great, and it's pulls it together.
Well, my question still wasn't answered.
Oh.
What they're doing now, is this an addition to what you already went for?
I'm not sure I understand the question.
Well,
right now,
initially, I don't think you had manufacturing in the kitchen, commercial kitchen. So you wanted
to
add.
In our draft?
Yeah.
Yes, we did.
No, not your draft, but what they're permitted to do at that site right now.
What they're permitted to do under the existing special permit, that's cultivation.
Yeah.
Okay.
It does not include product manufacturing. That's
okay.
Why we would like to do it there. Yeah.
Have you had an opportunity to look at this and do a crosswalk with your language?
I looked at the earlier version of it.
And yeah. Chris, have you also had have you guys had an opportunity to crosswalk your ideas?
He's not allowed to talk to me.
Oh, I'm sorry. Well, but you're allowed to talk to. Oh, you mean, okay, gotcha. But you don't have to talk to each other in order to do this, right?
I did take, as I said the last time, I took a pretty close look at Dick's
okay.
bylaw, and I incorporated a number of things from it that I thought were good
okay.
into this one.
And what did you add in?
that would be hard for me to try to go back and...
I mean,
Identify right at the moment, but...
And I read the one submitted, and I can tell you it was good. I think I can just, I'll use my own translation here, but the only, or the main difference I see is that the proposal submitted by Attorney Evans would allow for manufacturing in some RA districts. So it would allow it where they have cultivation right now. This one that we're looking at, it would not allow that. That's the big difference.
That's right, yeah. Ours actually allows it on parcels of 5 acres or more when co-located with a cultivation operation. So it limits it right. Substantially. Yeah.
And so that's just the biggest difference.
Okay. So initially,
And from everything that did, just again, my two senses, from everything I heard from the public over the past couple of years and from everything over the past couple of months here at the planning board, this is why we want to propose this one to the town. Because we don't think that we want to expand manufacturing into RA districts. That's my sense.
But
or the MO district that we're talking about.
Well, maybe the MO district. So that's why, as Chris started out, we need to start looking at the maps. Where do we want to put the marijuana overlay district? But to just leave it totally open that you can cultivate and manufacture.
But it wasn't totally open, right? It was under some very specific.
Right, but under our current laws, you could get cultivation in a lot of RA areas.
Yeah.
And then you could piggyback that with a manufacturer.
Okay.
That's why we're trying to separate them.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
I think the other thing that I would point out about this, and this is on. Again, apologize for no page numbers, but the top of page 6, physical requirements. All aspects of any marijuana establishment, and I'm paraphrasing, must take place at a fixed location within a fully enclosed building and shall not be visible from the exterior of the business. That's a really key point here, I think.
Everything's grown in this.
Everything's inside in an enclosed, secure environment.
Okay.
That's quite different from our previous one, because our previous one we thought you could grow outside
fences.
In the field.
Yeah. Right. So I think, you know, that might be a good chance to sort of segue into the issue of which district does it make sense to allow these types of uses in. Your current bylaw, as I understand it, allows some of the uses to take place in the marijuana overlay district and cultivation only in the RA, the I, and the PI districts based on the table of use regulations. So marijuana product manufacturer is allowed in the EPI district. Marijuana cultivator is allowed in the RA, the I, and the PI in your table of use regulations currently.
Okay.
What the folks that worked on this model bylaw suggest is that it's not appropriate to do any of these marijuana uses in an RA district, but that you could consider some of the existing districts in town for selected uses. And the table of uses that I developed gives you some suggestions for that. And just to kind of identify what they are, in the C2 district, based on the model, you could allow marijuana retailers, testing labs, or transporters. In the industrial district, you could allow cultivators and product manufacturers, and in the PI district, which you currently have established, all of these uses could be appropriate. Now, I guess the caveat that I would, you know, throw in about any of these is that the proximity of schools and residential uses to some of these districts is a big issue, and that's why I wanted to really kind of look at the map with you tonight and pulled out the big map,
So
maybe we can do that, because, you know, your industrial district butts up against Frontier, and pretty close to the elementary school. So I think just uniformly just saying, you know, the industrial district makes sense is problematic for those reasons. And there are also residential uses that abut some of the some of those other districts. Having said that, there's also provisions in the bylaw that create a buffer from schools. And the bylaw also says that no marijuana establishment can be can take place in a on a property that is directly abutting in a residential district. That's in the section on location, which is
well. If you think, I mean, that's kind of how our town has been planned for a long time. I mean, it seems like we shoehorned in commercial right here, but it's always surrounded by residential. And there's some industrial over here, but it's all surrounded by residential. I mean, it's a pretty hard thing to get around. I mean,
right.
And even up through 5 and 10, I mean, I don't think there's very many places where the commercial land goes much more than 200 or 300 feet down or back, I mean, away from the road, which is all surrounded by our district.
So the two sort of sections that I was just referring to are in the location section when we were talking about the buffer from schools and daycare centers. There's a 500-foot buffer that's in this bylaw. And then it also says further down in that section, a marijuana establishment can't be located on a parcel that abuts a residential use or a residential zoning district.
Where is that, Chris?
That's in the location section, which is the top of page 5.
Can we just go step back one more thing? How do I say this? What do we have to do? We want to be open and fair, or we want to be fair, I guess. I'm not sure. So what is the requirements? Do we even have to, could we just leave what we have right now, which is basically, it's full, and we know that, but we've already approved 2, and maybe 2 is all the town's going to have anyway.
Well, I think
I don't want to do too many exercises here. The reality is, we have the 2, we proved them, that's the way it is. I know we have to look to the future, but
if we don't make some changes, then we could have more and more and more with the even.
Right, but well, if we make changes in this, if we adopt this, but don't change our map. Because right now our map is the, you know,
overlay district.
The overlay district. I'm talking about the overlay district. Right. Yeah, don't change it. And it's very restrictive, but basically what we're saying is every place is going to be restrictive.
Well,
and the fact is that we have 2, and I think if you go by our alcohol license thing, that's about all we can have for now anyway.
I think that's right.
So yeah. I'm not sure why we want to go through lots of exercises to get nowhere.
I think the simplest thing,
does that make,
you know,
yes, it makes perfect sense to me,
might be to consider most of the uses that are in the table of use regulations here in your marijuana overlay district and just leave it as that. But the question is, you know, where do marijuana cultivators belong in town? And, you know, I think you've said, and I agree with you, that they don't belong in the RA district.
Yeah, in industrial.
So do you want to consider allowing marijuana cultivators in any additional districts besides the marijuana overlay district? Is really kind of the question, I think, that comes up. And I think you could consider the industrial district, the PI,
yeah,
for those uses, or maybe some subset of them.
It gets off that that's the whole PI. I mean, the industrial, you know, the industrial park is great. Big buildings.
Yeah,
you
can't do it.
Sorry.
Industrial
no,
park.
Right, no, not at this point.
Not at this point.
Because
there's a federal thing saying you can't because it's not approved by the federal government, and federal government put some money into that to create that park, and that's why it's not permitted in that zone or in that area.
They made that abundantly clear to us. They're very connected to that.
Who are they?
The
our deed.
The deed, yeah.
Right, so, but I think that could change in the future.
Well, I guess it could, but I mean, someone would have to vote on it, and it wouldn't be Deerfield voting on it.
Right.
But it doesn't,
that's not the only industrial area.
It leads us to still.
No, I know that, but that's our overlay district, that's what John was saying. Do we restrict it to our overlay district, or do we create a new one?
Well, it sounds like we're making a new one.
Well, that's what he.
That's what I'm questioning.
That's what he asked.
That's all I'm saying, yeah. And
well, isn't that what, this is Roger here?
Yes, but that's what he asked, do we need to go through this process if we don't really think it's worthy of it?
Well, do you want to look at the map? And
yes.
Yeah, where else could, and where I guess the other, yeah, where else is industrial? Would be your first question.
It's not
the
only industrial.
I don't know where to spread this out.
Right.
Actually, I know, I wish we had a nice hooks or something. We don't, but it might be able to hang over there.
Maybe spread it out where Dick is, because this is cluttered, and we all get up and just take a look at it.
Yeah, we can stretch that.
Now, how's this EPD going to be affected by being surrounded by RA?
Well, we're not considering EPD necessarily.
No, well, I'm looking at his chart here.
Yeah, that was one of the things.
And that was one of the things that was in that chart that he's got laid out.
You could consider, but because of the close proximity of residential to that, I think that's problematic.
So this is all residential here.
So just take that out of the EPD.
I mean, our current, we say that with a special permit, you could put a manufacturer or a lab in the EPD. But now we're saying, no.
They're changing it here.
Well, manufacturer.
So just to be clear, this table doesn't reflect your current bylaw.
No, this is the current.
Yeah, okay.
That's what I was reading.
Okay.
And so you did say a manufacturer could go there, and now you're saying it could still do that.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's, you know, and these independent testing labs are really,
I don't think those really matter.
Small labs, they could go,
even like the transport something more than a small trucking company.
Yeah, that's kind of fine. So the other industrial. This is the industrial that you said.
That's up by
borders,
Pelican.
Residential.
Isn't this up by Pelican somewhere?
Yeah.
Pelican and this is actually a Channing Beach.
That's Channing Beach, maybe.
Yeah. Right, but with Pelican, there's a lot of homes in front of their property.
Yeah, that's
yeah.
But that's why we have to talk about
it. Half in industrial.
I still feel sad. You still have opportunity along here.
So by saying that you could cultivate or manufacture in all of I, then we're saying that where Channing LB, that's an empty building right now, and a manufacturer might want to move in there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And
is that good or bad?
That'd be great.
The access has to go through to get back to the back of these lots, though. isn't this all part, the front of it's RA and the back of it is I, up to this track here?
Yeah, but we're talking coming off 5 and 10. Where's 5 and 10?
Well, that's the thing. Do we get in from there?
5 and 10 is right here.
Oh, is that 91? That's 5 and 10, yeah.
Right there.
So that's 91 there.
So that's Chandler Beach building right there, and that's Pelican right there.
See, this whole property's been landlocked, and we tried to split it here, and we had to change it last
You're
time.
You're talking about where Pelican is.
Yeah, just south sort of the... Well, no, Pelican is where.
Now you're talking about all this, which is
that landlocked with the RA.
No, that isn't.
It isn't?
No, that's off of 5 and 10. That's where the that clinic is, and that's where Yankee Candle, where the houses are.
Yeah.
Okay. Right.
So if that got turned into marijuana, anybody could be mad.
I thought somewhere in here was the adult entertainment overlay.
You're right, it was.
just the thought here.
Yeah, there you go. Hallucination.
Yeah.
And then C2 is up here, which is
the railroad yard.
Yeah.
It's also here.
Yeah, so I think that's where there's a potential for a retailer or a lab.
Right.
Retail, John, or
no.
More of a manufacturing?
Lab or manufacturing.
Well, the question is, where would you want a retailer to be if you had, you know, a retailer in the town? Would it be in the special districts?
Maybe an overlay district?
I think the overlay. That's when we first looked at
that's
it.
That's the way...
That's how we generated it. We thought that was...
And I think everybody wanted it that way. They wanted it like confined to a certain area so
right.
They could monitor it.
But what we're saying is, should we expand the overlay?
We wanted to bring people into downtown. Things like that. Yes, we do. After they buy
somebody
their
wanted
right,
to
and they keep going.
The
<next
show.
laughs> I mean, right, but it's not all that far.
But right now, the overlay district is it's full, let's say.
Yeah.
Because you can't do it in the at the Dedek land, and the other one's already been approved.
Mm-hmm. Which one is the Dedek land?
Dedek is PI, sorry.
Yeah.
Oh, planning cluster. So the question is, do we want to open some more of this to
C2
to retail?
And then that opens up that land.
Well, no, or we put an overlay district just down here. I think that's what I was going to get to. I don't think we want
to
deal with up here, because I remember when the police talked, they really didn't want to have it out hidden in the railroad.
Yeah, but then somebody came in and they were interested in converting one of those sort of empty sites, and then I thought the police said it was perfectly fine.
Yeah, I think we might want to ask about that, because that is a part of town that is under...
Where's that? Where's your stuff?
It's up in the rear.
Where's your stuff located here? Right back in here?
Yeah, it's in the other.
Is this why
you're right?
Yeah.
Well, it's an area.
Yeah, I think that's us right there. That's us. No, there's an anaerobic digester.
So we could make this in the...
if they can survive.
Overlay district up here.
Yeah, but you know, check with the powers to be and see if there's any issues, but I thought they said there wasn't.
At the beginning,
they wanted it like in a very tight little area, and then afterwards, yeah, anywhere.
Right.
And maybe it was more of a grow facility up in the industrial, mm-hmm. I mean the railroad, the C2.
Right, I don't think we want a marijuana retailer up here. There's no other retail that would
right,
make
right.
sense.
So they probably wouldn't
But you might want to allow retailers in this C2, so it really is that overlay.
You're right. I agree with you, John.
So you might have sort of a two-part overlay district.
Yeah,
actually.
Instead of saying
yeah.
C2, you got to say a marijuana overlay for cultivation, a marijuana overlay for retail.
I think we absolutely could do that.
That's a proposal. And the C2 up in, we call this the railroad yard up here, for cultivation.
And
And what are we saying about this industrial district here?
Cultivation.
There's a pretty big chain, piece of property now.
That isn't, the viability of that is impacted by the residential proximity to residents.
It is to some degree. I don't know what the scale of this.
When Chris looked at these things, he looked at other people's drafts or their regulations, and they thought it was very important, I guess, because they said not close to residential. So that's something for our community to decide on.
Right, and that's what makes that part less viable, because it's so close to.
Right.
Well, but this is not close to residential.
Right.
Not off of 5 and 10.
Right.
But like North Main, Pelican, that piece of property is.
I'm wondering on proximity to Frontier, I guess. You know, so we've got a 500-foot buffer. I'm not sure how big that would be. I was looking for a scale on this map.
But on this side of.
Right, so the overlay district, you take the railroad tracks maybe and you just see.
Or the highway.
Between the railroad tracks.
Just a portion of this eye?
Yeah, that's the railroad tracks. So on that side of the railroad tracks, because this is all residential, right?
Right, but if the parcel abuts a residential district, then that disqualifies it essentially under the regulations.
Unless we, so I guess that's why I wasn't clear. You have the buffer, so why not just use the buffer and not, why are we worried about the whole border?
So I was going to say the same thing. You could use the 500-foot buffer and just use the industrial areas. But somebody said that might make it problematic, you know, deciding, you know, because people come in. But I wouldn't think so. You know, if you're going to be really interested in some of this property and it was within 500 feet, you know, that would be off limits. But
is this Pelican here?
Yeah.
Because this is the entrance off of the road here to get to it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, Frontier's right here, but then there's some rumor there's some property that abuts almost up to the industrial land, going to be sold. It's privately owned by a residential person, mm-hmm. and they're thinking maybe purchasing that for playing fields and stuff.
Because the buffer and the border thing are similar reasons, isn't it, Chris?
Yes. Yeah, to protect schools and to protect residential areas.
Right. Okay. So it seems like the buffer almost does that better than border.
It does, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, we
could
design whatever.
Just call it all and say it has to be 500 feet away.
So, what I'm hearing you say, just to make sure I understand it clearly, is that we might have two marijuana overlay districts, one that would be for cultivators, one is for retailers and processing. And the first district, which would be the. The retailers and processing would include the existing marijuana overlay district and the two C2 districts here.
Is this deeded back here?
Yes.
That's C2.
But not this C2 district and not this C2 district. And the second district would be for cultivators, which would include all of this area, but also the industrial districts and this C2.
North, south. I'm going to get you to sign in.
Yeah.
So that would allow use of buildings and places that.
In appropriate areas, not like in a residential area.
Got a fertilizer plant in the same.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah.
Are you with
Cogrets
too?
No, I'm
just. And with all the other things, we're all having to be totally in the building.
Sawmill.
Emily. Hey, Emily.
Yeah, hi. I'm playing. I guess we're just playing.
So
I'm playing.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Hi.
This C2 district
What's the
transition? It's Nutrien or something.
This is 5 and 10.
The store is housing
that's North Main Street. It goes all the way up to.
His Magic Wings.
His Magic Wings. It goes,
You play storage units, you got your Volvo garage, and the auction house, and the gables. There's a bunch of antique places all through here.
A little retail.
That seems perfectly retail to me.
Yeah, it does.
So that's okay, yeah.
Yeah.
Indoor cultivation?
I don't know.
If you wanted to, I would think, but.
See, that.
Pretty small.
Well, the other thing is in a town, you want. The storage is not appropriate. A lot of people have commented on that.
Yes, you still have to sign. Still, yes, I know.
Like that, you kind of want places, services or retail.
Well, you can draw the same paycheck.
So having a building that just grown.
Yeah, it comes as easy, better attendance, most of the time.
Well, I know, I understand what you're saying, but they're gonna buy the piece of property and that's what they choose to do with it. That's what it is, and we can plan all this stuff and it's gonna be survival of the fittest, you know, these.
Right, but we can say they can't do it.
Right, I know.
That's right.
I know what you're saying, well, you know, how many of these things are really gonna be used by residents anyways? You know, you can't just say, well, no one's gonna use it from town, so we won't.
Well, here's, then you get to a public hearing, a town meeting, you know you're gonna hear people question, we don't want a retail.
Well, they don't, they'll vote against it.
But we wanna propose something that we think.
Well, pass, I know, that makes, is sensible, that's what, you're right.
I don't think, I think people will, are less likely to vote for cultivation than retail there.
But here, no one's gonna object to cultivation.
I don't think anybody will. You know, I don't know, I don't, you know, there's some homes that have bought that area. They were pretty vocal about the salt shed, you know.
Well, there are here, this is where. Well, actually, this is agricultural back here.
What's there versus greenhouses or building there.
This is probably, this is Norse Farm, just one of that.
I live there, probably wouldn't.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Right, so actually, if we're gonna overlay, it's really like back here where we want to overlay. Not here, and this is not. Okay, but then you're kind of getting into this whole spot.
Well, I didn't have an argument, I guess, that the residential buffering protects these properties.
Oh, right.
But I'm not sure.
Would you mind speaking into the microphone so we all can hear you at home?
All right, did we conclude something here, or?
Yeah.
I couldn't hear a thing.
You couldn't hear. You want me to try to summarize again?
That's okay.
No?
I get the gist of it.
No, yes, no, I think that's.
Oh, you need to summarize.
Right.
Okay, so let me see if I can try to summarize. What I'm hearing is that we are suggesting the establishment of two marijuana overlay districts. One which is a marijuana retail overlay district, one which is a cultivator district. And we're gonna have to make some decisions about these other half dozen uses, that which ones fit really into which of those categories.
Mm-hmm.
But in terms of location, the retail marijuana overlay district would be the C2 district, in the lower and the middle sections of that C2 district. The cultivator district would be the upper C2, the existing marijuana overlay district, and the industrial district. Is that correct?
Yes. What I didn't hear was the mention of the 5 acres like we have. So, I mean, if you have commercial area, you're suggesting that it has to be a minimum of 5 acres like we currently have in the RA. I think that's kind of overkill for that.
Tell me where that provision is, because I.
For cultivators.
Yes. Because when you start speaking of cultivators in the C2 district, that's when I was just curious.
It was just the upper C2 district where the rail yard is.
Right, but are we gonna put an area size limitation to it, like it has to be 5 acres or it can be any size?
Okay, let's
5 acres and over or 5 acres and under?
Or just any size, as long as it's in.
Right now, it's.
It's right now, it's 5 acres more.
Okay.
The land ownership, not the building.
Right.
So that's in your existing bylaw.
I think that's.
Can you tell me where?
That was so that.
What if you're a little tiny grower?
Me with 1 acre property, you can't put it in.
Follow the numbers right here, so it's in 46.
I mean, I'm not saying it has to be 5 acres, I'm just saying that since it's in there, should we change it?
No, but what I'm saying.
If we're gonna say it's gonna be in C2 now, and somebody's gonna do it, they only have 2 acres.
But you wanna have a little boutique.
Right, I think there's not a lot of C2 out there, it's 5 acres.
Right.
To sell it commercially, I mean, that's a different.
Is it in that? Is it in existing?
Right, but I'm saying, we have a little boutique business, a little guy who wants to grow whatever his specialty is.
Cause I don't remember seeing that.
But he doesn't have the capital for 5 acres, are we excluding him?
You have where cultivators are, Chris?
This is your existing.
Yeah.
Bylaw.
Yes, we are.
Right.
And is this for the overlay, or is this for?
Kip, do you know where the 5 acre provision is in?
We're looking for it, I don't have it in front of me, Chris, right?
Okay.
So, right now, it's. Can you explain this to me, I'm sorry, more than 5 acres?
5 acres or more.
And what?
And nothing, it could be anywhere in an RA district. There it is, 4665.
Okay.
Two.
See the number again, 46 what?
Okay.
4665.
Oh, yeah, I see it, okay, so that is a good point.
Except the minimum lot size for marijuana establishment in RA shall be 5 acres.
And that's not in here right now, so you want that.
No, no, I'm saying, it doesn't, I just don't want there to be a confusion, because if we change it saying it's not gonna be allowed in RA, but it is gonna be in C2, but then we don't address this 5 acre thing, then, you know, it's gonna really.
That's a really good point.
Cut out a lot of.
Yeah, cause there aren't that many.
Just to buy a couple lots or something and to do it.
So what is your recommendation, what, how do you wanna handle that issue?
I think if we're gonna allow it in C2, I just allow it in C2.
Without the 5 acre minimum?
Without the 5 acre minimum, yeah.
Does everybody else agree with that?
I mean, I always felt that that's how it should have been in the first place, instead of in the residential, but.
Well, people were concerned it's gonna happen.
I know, it's gonna help the farmers and stuff.
Well, it wasn't even help the farmers, but they thought, you know, it'd be popping up on, well, it says Center Village District, but they were afraid it'd pop up in the center on Eastern Avenue or wherever, you know. And they didn't want that, there was no 5 acre lot, so that's how they excluded it.
Right.
And now that we know, it's all inside and everything, then it doesn't matter as much of the acreage, I think. And there is the buffer, there's still the, you know, there's still the 500-foot buffer.
And that wasn't even us, was.
And it, doesn't the state regulations say that they can't have more than 100,000 square feet anyways, so.
Cultivation,
so. I mean, it's just a little more than 2 acres if somebody did, if they actually had, if they wanted to build the largest possible facility. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so for the next time, I can try to get together a table of use regulations and a overlay map that you can consider, and then you'll have a pretty clear decision to make about that.
The more I think about it, I don't think that we really need to address how much land, because if it's in C2, the existing land is going to dictate, you know, what size facility they can have. If they only have 2 acres, obviously they can't build a 100,000 square foot building on 2 acres. By the time you comply with all the setbacks and things like that and coverage.
Right.
So, you know, that would dictate the size of the operation. So if somebody came in with a very large scale operation that, the size of a lot would preclude a lot of them from establishing in that area.
Right. Might be helpful to look at the existing lots in that district, mm-hmm. to see what size they are.
Mm-hmm. But people can combine them too.
That's true.
Well, you can.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, you'd have to buy a couple pieces.
You'd have to buy a couple. Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, I can put that together for you for next time.
So then on the table, would it be no every place and then have this marijuana overlay where you say yes?
This table's gonna get kind of tossed out and we're gonna have a new table that's gonna have two marijuana overlay districts and it'll specifically define which of these uses are in each of those districts, and that is a question for all of you. You know, this retail district that we're talking about, it could include testing laboratories and it could include transporters as well,
mm-hmm.
but under the way the model is structured.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to include those in the retail overlay?
I would think that both of those are pretty benign
parts
mm-hmm. of the yeah. marijuana business.
Makes sense.
You know,
I mean.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And then there's the question of product manufacturer, I think is really the other category. It seems to me that should be in the cultivator overlay district, but does that make sense to you?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Product manufacturer in the overlay district?
In the cultivator version of
cultivator,
not in the retail.
But DPD would fall in. Was the EPD going to fall into that, or is that going to be out of it?
A what?
The EPD.
Oh, I'm sorry. That district.
That's the one that's circulated.
I think we decided to take the EPD out altogether. Is that
just,
correct?
Yeah.
Yes. So that would not be in either of the districts.
I don't know why we
districts.
Take it out.
I'm just talking, like, when you said the manufacturer, and, like, we'll say the C2 on 5 and 10, what harm would it cause if we had it there? I wouldn't think any, but that's just me talking.
Yeah, I think it goes more with, like, research and lab and that kind of thing, more than with cultivator, actually.
I mean, either place would be fine in my mind, but that's just me.
Yep.
Okay.
And I don't see any reason to exclude EPD just because currently that's not, I mean, that could change.
So there's about 12 acres left there, I believe.
Right, but what I'm saying is that leave that in the overlay even if that doesn't happen,
mm-hmm.
let it not happen. And I'm saying it's not happening today or next year or 2 years. But
How would the 500 feet, Rachel, how would that, from residential, how would that narrow that piece of property down, because there's residential
all the way around.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I mean, you could do it, but
so much.
Go ahead.
I was just saying, when you throw that 500 feet in, I mean,
that really shrinks it down.
Yeah, because I mean, all the way from Mill Village Road, way past my house, none of those lots are 500.
It's a little.
Feet.
I know. That's why we said that. You know, it's going to create, and it was wherever Chris got this from that. Community, that's what they wanted, not the budding. Yet. So we said we'll use the 500 foot, but you're right, it's going to kill a lot of those places.
Mm-hmm. Just to be clear, though, the 500 foot buffer is for schools and daycare centers.
Oh, not residential.
Well, there's
no, we're going to create it for residential.
But the provision for residential, the way it reads right now, is they cannot be located on a parcel which abuts a residential use or a residential zoning district.
Right, so we said that's going to exclude a lot of stuff, so we leave a 500 foot. But
plus is a nursery school, there's a daycare center.
But think about it, from Mill Village Road all the way to Greenfield, there are no pieces of land like that. So why even have it in there?
Well,
you know, we're creating an area that you can't use.
If you're thinking of like...
because of the proximity of the RA district.
Mill Village, I mean, there's... But a lot of it's like, and we need to address this, a lot of that land is... The developmental rights are gone on it,
yeah.
And a lot of it would never see homes on it, Kip. You know, you think from where the condos are off of Mill Village.
I agree with you, but that's kind of one of the crazy things about a lot of our bylaws is that it says a residential area. The RA district is a residential area. Now, just because that land is being protected through some sort of a program, it's still an RA district. So now how are we going to have to go around and change all the districts so we're not
You bring up a point, I guess, but you would never see homes there.
No,
but you're right, it's classified.
It's classified.
So. Right.
Mm-hmm. If you're going to have two overlays.
But we need to address that because this last time with the marijuana thing, they said that they superintended our zoning regulations and used that land. In Northampton, you can't do that to
right.
get around things.
Right.
We need
even if you lowered that number down to 100 feet, every piece of land on Route 5 and 10 abuts an RA district. So if we create the C2 district, we're creating it, but you can't use it, so.
So do you want to lower it to 200 feet or something, or what?
No, you can't have any, because every piece.
You don't want 100 feet, it's not.
He's pretty, he's right, John, because every piece of land abuts in the RA district all.
Oh, right, but if we got rid of the abut and we used the buffer instead, and then we lowered the buffer, that's what we're saying.
It's still like, just look at Billiduders or any of those buildings right there, John. On the west side, that RA comes right up, there's like a ditch or the old railroad bit. So if you put 100 feet, it makes a lot of them, it cuts their size down quite a bit.
So do we want to, what I'm saying is, do we want to have a definition, so, I don't think so that does fit there?
If you're going to do that, then you can't have a buffer zone. It's you know, that parcel land or whatever is going to abut it.
That's what I'm saying, do we want to not have a buffer zone? Do we not want to have the border or the buffer?
If you feel that the C2 is the way to go, then yeah, you do away with C2. Well, no, us in general, if it's something we're going to speak to the community.
What do we think we accomplish with a buffer zone?
Well,
we were just trying to protect residential areas, that's all.
But I'm saying, like, how does that protect them? Like, realistically,
Well, it just keeps them further away, that's all. I mean, it's just like when the state put their regulations in from a daycare center or school, 500 feet. You know, I guess the kids aren't going to be tempted to walk over there, I don't know.
Right, they're going to, I struggle with the usefulness of a buffer zone. Like, what are we really accomplishing?
Because the liquor store.
Somebody else dreamed that up, we didn't really.
So maybe we don't have to use it?
No, for the schools.
We don't have to, that's what I said.
Oh, right, for the schools, I know.
For the residential, I said, that was another community, we don't have to follow that.
Right.
If you're going to pick and choose your stuff, and you have two overlay districts, one for manufacturing and one for cultivating, then you don't even, you should have all ends and the rest of these.
You know, the hesitation I have about marijuana product manufacturer is the odor issue. I think that's the big impact on residential uses. And I wouldn't be comfortable having a manufacturer located within 200 feet of my house, would you? Yeah, I mean, maybe you don't know what these things
smell. Well, I'm right next to EPD, so I guess I just...
but that doesn't smell like this.
Pretty strong odors. Pretty powerful odors that are present.
But you know, but they're treating, you're supposed to be treating it coming out of the...
Manufacturing.
The manufacturing part, right?
But I've gone by hemp fields, and I think the odor is... And I'll ask experts, is that odor the same from a hemp field or marijuana that you smoke?
It's much stronger from a marijuana field than a hemp field.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh, no kidding. But I mean, it wasn't like a skunk smell. You could.
That's pretty. I went by those.
Yes, but it isn't like, you know, like.
It's pretty powerful.
You can smell it, but it isn't like, you know, no worse than maybe a.
It's a horse of a different color.
It
really is. It really is.
Yeah, so I wouldn't know then. But, yeah. But I mean, if it was just stronger.
You can smell the hemp field from probably a half a mile away.
Yeah, quite a ways. You're right.
Strongly.
Yeah.
So here's the thing, if someone were to say, desire to do this, isn't there, don't the abutters have to be notified and aren't they allowed to?
Well, we're always saying it's a special permit, so that's the point, is that there's always going to be input from neighbors.
Right, but I think we're in
Mary.
was coming from, it's like, yes, they can come in and speak their two cents, but if they meet our regulations.
Right. Yeah, yeah.
You can't stop
them. Yeah, yeah. You're right. Yeah.
So I'm curious, we haven't got input from, we have some people here. Anybody else want to give us any guidance or opinions on this? You guys, I think, have more experience with this.
Well, there's maybe two people that are residents of Deerfield. The rest of them are sightseers.
There isn't even two.
Okay.
That's right.
There's one then.
Who's one?
Matt.
Yeah.
But anybody can, I mean, we're not saying you have to be a resident here to talk. So, you know, you've seen this in other towns. Is this a struggle that everybody has, or, you know?
When I first started with this company, they took me to Maryland. And they've got a facility in Maryland that is a cultivation, and they just built the manufacturing part of it right next to it. And it's right behind the high school. It's in the middle of a residential area. And the goal here, the big part of this, is the fact that this is completely fenced in, completely secured, and like it was said today, it's sheathed.
In other words, it's not plastic. It's sheathing all the way around. So it looks more like a Butler building than anything else. And inside is it's got compartments in there for each part of the process. And there's filtration that's going through all of that. I'm an asthmatic. I'm not an asthmatic, but I'm allergic to everything. And believe me, I am allergic to that stuff. So bottom line is, they were harvesting in there, and I was in the building when they were doing it. And there's a smell in there, but it wasn't as bad as I thought it was going to be. So, I mean, that's part of, as part of the restrictions and that sort of thing, is that, and this is something that this company is pretty adverse with, that would make this, like I say, the smell of that area would be minimal for that. I mean,
Yeah, and I know, just work with the company, it also depends on the type of equipment they use, and I know we always use the top equipment, top filtration devices. And I've also been to the a lot of the facilities. The one he's referring to is in Hancock, Maryland. Even if you drive up to it, you really can't. There's like houses literally right across the street, and you really can't really smell it unless you drive up close to it. Because I know that one, we have a pretty high, like, top end piece of because of all the houses like around it, and it hasn't been a problem. People in the neighborhood were very welcoming and never had any issues or any complaints.
Where's the nearest comparable facility? So if we wanted to take a drive, that's
probably
similar.
Maryland.
Okay.
For us.
I go to Maryland.
Yes, for us. There are facilities in Massachusetts.
Yeah, but
I'll find
one. Okay, I will go to one.
I think we should probably take
go to Franklin.
Go to one.
They give samples?
Franklin.
But, you know,
if you take the tour.
Yes.
But I know, like, some others might, it might be a stronger smell because we don't know what type of stuff that they're using or filtration devices that they're using.
I mean, we have it in our bylaws. You can't have any odor outside of your property, but.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's
you
really.
You enforce that and.
Well, you smell dryer sheets.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, we have it in there, right?
I talked to an engineer who was designing filtration systems for one facility in eastern Massachusetts, and his experience was that when he was driving up to the facility from several blocks away with his car windows up, he could smell the facility from several blocks away. So that's the other side
so
of the story.
To design a better
system. Right.
Well, I could have swore the other day I was driving down the road and a trail truck went by me, a box truck, and it smells just like a hemp field. And I go, there had to be hemp on that truck or marijuana or something. I go, but maybe I was hallucinating.
I mean, you know, candles, pickles.
So there is a reason for buffers and stuff, but the bordering thing, I think, is crazy because, it's like you say, everything borders it.
Yes, that's the way our town is involved.
Well, that's why I think, you know, personally, I would separate out the manufacturer into the cultivator district, and I would keep the retailers, the labs, and the transporters in district where you're maybe perhaps less concerned about
good point.
That issue. So I'll try to structure something that way and bring it back to you for discussion for next time.
With a
overlay. Well, how would that affect our
time frame for the
our current overlay
well,
district
I guess
where they're allowed, both are allowed right now?
Well, this would replace your current bylaw and overlay district as we were discussing it.
So I think are we safe to say that the wording, the narrative is pretty good. And it's really now we're starting to really get into the overlay district, which is a good sign.
Moving
forward.
Yes.
I mean, so then as far as timing goes, what would that look like? We do want to get this to the town meeting, and that's, does anybody know?
April
28th.
Wasn't it the last end of April?
Yeah, I thought it was the last, whatever, in April.
What is the date here on the calendar? So it's a Monday, it could be a 30th, March 30th, April 27th, and May 4th for voting.
So we do have
so one, two,
timing
three,
in between when we have the public hearing and when we have the annual meeting.
Can't forget Mr. Evans's proposal.
Well, no, that's if we're not gonna do this in February, then maybe we just do that one in February. And then we do this one in March. And then we'll know which one, you know, both going to town meeting in April.
Someone stated, though, if we have a public hearing on it, that we have to bring that to town meeting like a vote?
No.
Or is, if we say no, that we don't think that is a good...
I think you have a public hearing.
Doesn't mean, we need to vote on it.
You just bring and talk about it.
Okay, I just wanted, you know...
The planning board will make a decision whether to recommend it to town meeting or not. But that doesn't mean the bylaw still doesn't proceed to town meeting. It may still proceed to town meeting without your recommendation.
Right, but they would have to get signatures and everything.
The select board could move it.
Right.
Yeah.
You could end up in a situation where you have two marijuana bylaws at town meeting at the same time.
And if we recommend one and don't recommend the other, then the town knows we did our due diligence and...
Well, you'd hope they would.
Well, they know we did it, whether they accept it or not.
Yeah.
I don't know, it would be better if we just have one, all right?
All right, so you want to do that? So our February meeting, we'll do a public hearing on the one that's been out there for a couple months, I guess. And then we'll also have an agenda just
to review what we went over.
Further discussion on this one.
I have all of these.
Which is good, actually, then we'll get more, public input. I think people will be here, so they might stick around.
Hopefully.
It'll almost be like an informal public hearing for this one. All right.
Where'd you get that?
My pile of stuff.
All right, nice. So is that a agreement? Do we have to vote or we just agree? Let's vote.
No, do we not?
Well, we have to vote to have to hold a public hearing on the proposed marijuana bylaw submitted by Attorney Evans.
On behalf of Evans.
Have that on February.
Attorney Evans, is it?
This is great. I'm not going to be here February 4th, so let's do it then.
February 4th, 2020.
You know who's next in line, Rachel?
What?
Dick.
Your vice, so you're...
I know, I think I'm...
Attorney Evans.
You're going to be what?
Is this yours?
Dick consulted the board or something?
I'm going to be away.
That's, yeah, I just gave John the latest...
Right, so we have this letter. And it's in the...
So when are you leaving, John, and when are you coming back?
I come back the 8th. It's 2 weeks, so last week of January, the first week of February.
Do you want to write Dick on it?
Well, do I get to keep it? I don't think so.
But I think if we have a quorum on the 3rd, then you have to have, I think you have to have a meeting.
There you go.
I'll send in my written comments.
I don't think, where does it say we have to have a meeting? Boy, you're...
I was trying to push that one through the other edge.
Yeah, well, I'm sleeping, but not down.
Well, you missed the second one, so that's not good. You're going to be here, need a meeting or something.
You're more important than I am.
That's why I do not believe that.
So you went to the 4th from the 3rd, is that what you're saying?
Well, the 3rd is the Monday, sorry. I was thinking of another meeting there. So February 3rd is our normal meeting. And then I would say we try to stick to that, and then the first Monday of March, and if something goes wrong, then we might need a special second meeting in March or something, but I think...
Second of March.
Well, I think the more people that are present from the planning board, the better we are. That's why...
I totally agree. Here's, yeah, that's why I am gonna...
You have a lot of...
Are you here on the 3rd?
Input.
I'm here on the 3rd, but not on the, in March. I am...
All right, but you chair the one in February, I'll chair the one in March.
Okay, fair.
All right, so, motion to have the public hearing.
We ended the public hearing, didn't we?
No, it's it. On February 3rd, then we'll have a public hearing on the proposed zoning amendment submitted by Evans Cutler Attorneys.
Right.
On behalf of, in this case. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye, opposed, abstained.
Who moved it, who seconded?
I skipped that part. I moved it.
I seconded.
Rachel seconded.
And it's February 3rd?
3rd.
Yeah.
7th?
7 o'clock?
Yeah.
Last time I chaired a meeting...
Or should we do it earlier?
No.
No, that one goes from 7 to 8, and then this one from 8 to 9. Or do it earlier.
Well...
We'll ask him how much he's going to talk.
I think 7 o'clock is fine.
Okay.
7.
Dick, when did you give this to the board selection?
I know, I'm having a...
October?
Yeah, this says 10:30. Mine has a date on it. It says 10:30.
She's got it in her pile.
I got it in my pile.
I don't have it on mine. I have... Nashville, Northampton. I have everything else.
Can I just mention one other thing? Because it's on the agenda, but it affects the timing of the public hearing. We were also going to do a public hearing on the floodplain bylaw on that date. So do you want to consider whether you want to change the time of the meeting? Because there'd be two public hearings that night.
And go early with the floodplain? Start at 6?
Sure.
Is anybody okay with that? Anybody?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear what you said.
So we start at 6, we open the floodplain bylaw.
6 o'clock for the floodplain?
Yeah.
Yep.
And then move to marijuana after that.
And then you still are going to have your regular meeting where we're going to discuss the planning board's marijuana bylaw after that?
In March.
Right.
Okay, just want to make sure.
Oh, that one's not, John thought we were going to discuss, like, Mr. Evans's, and then we might even discuss ours, because there might be people here and we'd get...
Well, we will discover this marijuana overlay district.
No, notices don't have to go out to anybody, because it's the whole town, right?
Well, you have to put it in the newspaper for...
Well, I know, you have to put something in the newspaper, but how do you...
Right, so is that you who does that, since you're the proponent?
Well, there are some notices to go out. I'd be happy to...
There's no postcard thing, but it's just in the newspaper, I think.
The statute lays out some notices, but yeah, I'd be happy to just put those together. Help you out on that. I just want to say that on the public hearing, I don't have a whole lot to say. I don't think you need to book a lot of time. You've heard everything I have to say. And, you know, it's really for the town meeting that's where there's going to be a discussion, debate.
All right.
And what's the name of the company that's...
It's Gogriz.
Gogriz?
G-O-G-R-I-Z, LLC.
LLC. Gogriz LLC.
Does that stand for something?
Not that I know of.
All right.
So thank you.
Thank you.
Well, did we vote on that?
If I can't find it, then I...
You started to vote on it, then you...
We voted. We're going to have a public hearing on this.
6-0-0 for both?
Yes.
Okay.
What's the second one?
6 o'clock.
6 o'clock for the floodplain?
Oh, sorry.
And you said, oh, we didn't decide the time and the date, so you went backwards, and then we didn't ever vote.
6 o'clock, floodplain, 7 o'clock.
So ours will be scheduled for 7 o'clock?
Correct.
7, yeah. So I'll put down those two anyways.
Who typically does your advertising for public hearings for you?
Good question. Have you ever done the advertising for public hearings?
Yeah.
So you can help. So if you can work with Dick on that one, and then Chris, you can help with the floodplain one?
Yeah.
All right. Great. Thanks. Yeah, there's certain a two-week thing, and then two notices.
Right.
All right. Anything else on that? And then else we'll go. We have one more new business.
Yep.
First reading, site plan review, Smith's Interconnected, 6 North Street.
Yep.
It's an application for a site plan, proposed building addition, 6 North Street. On behalf of the applicant, Renaissance Builders, we enclose materials pertaining to the above referenced application for site plan review for 2,996 square foot building addition under the Deerfield zoning bylaws, section 5411. The following materials pertaining to the application: we have a site plan review application, we have a fee of $1,400, we have a narrative with waiver request. Certified abutters list is here, there's a CD with a digital file, project plan set. If you have any questions, call Jesse Moreno. So this is for 3,000 square foot addition building on North Street, what's the building, what's the current building?
Well, it's the old Abercrombie distribution building near where the old refab used to be. I did a little research because I was in the office and I saw this last couple weeks ago. The current lot only contains 22,651 square feet. The current building and parking lot covers 16,481 feet. So they're already at 73.9% coverage without their addition. Current building, actually the back portion of the building sits on the abutter's land, and it doesn't meet the side back requirements on two of the four sides, or actually three of the four sides. So if they put the addition, if we allow the addition on the front of the building, their coverage would increase to over 85%, and there would be no parking. They said that they had made some sort of arrangements with the neighbors that they could use the neighbor's land for parking.
What building is this?
Acceptable, but
you know where North Street is?
Yeah.
You go down North Street, it'd be the first building on the right-hand side. I don't know what's in there right now.
It's behind the barbecue.
Right. Right here. Okay, yeah.
But I don't know where the lot lines are. So
they cut that in half. Isn't it the barbecue's the front half of the lot, the back?
No. If you want to look at it, John, this is the lot.
Can you hand that to me?
From the assessor's map, the building's on the neighbor's land. I spoke to the person who used to own this just tonight, and he said, yeah, they've always known it, and it's always been acceptable. You can see how close it is there. They want to extend the building to within 8 feet of the property line.
That's nice.
Kip, who owns that open lot right now?
Sheckley.
All right, he bought it all from Fred.
Was a potato factory there or something?
Storage.
That's gone.
What they also say is that there's an expansion of the existing building. The purpose of the expansion of warehouse space is to support the forecasted additional revenue in 2020 and house the need for an additional 3 to 4 employees to support revenue increase.
What do they do out of the building?
They make some sort of, excuse me?
Thank you.
His question first is that they make some sort of electronic.
Oh, that's what they do there now?
Was that the building they just painted? Is that the building they just painted up there?
No. You think it was.
It was the car museum at one time.
Right.
Yeah.
This is on.
Yeah, it was the car museum.
East side of North Street.
Yeah. Yankee Candle's over here. Yeah. This is the railroad tracks, and this is the lumber yard. And it's that building right there.
What are they in between?
Yeah.
But
okay.
I mean, if
and that's right behind the barbecues out here.
Yeah.
Right?
How is that even?
If they're going to exceed the coverage, there's no parking.
They already exceeded. No.
So what's the? So I do. We have a letter of a request for comments, and our building commissioner said no comments or concerns.
Seems legit.
I talked with him about that today.
Which
so
one?
What did he say?
He said that he doesn't care about the building. He says as far as the lot lines and all that is our job. I did say, well, you are the zoning enforcement agent.
So we should work. I mean, we haven't worked much with him, so we have. I mean, I'd like to get him to tell us.
Well, I mean, basically, that's what we do with site plan is to make sure that the building has the proper setbacks and it doesn't exceed the coverage.
Well, they're asking for a special permit. I guess is it for they're going not to have the parking on someone else's property? I guess.
I don't think that's.
That's not. You're creating a big problem.
Yeah.
Because you know the current owner of the adjacent land might say, hey. Great, go ahead and do this.
Yeah,
then they sell the land, and then what do these people do? Now you got cars in the road and stuff like that.
Oh, so here it is. The applicant is requesting a special permit from the Zoning Board of Appeals, so that's not us, right? For the extension of the existing non-conforming use and the extension of the non-conforming structure.
Oh, so they're looking for relief from the coverage.
They're looking for us for site plan review.
Right. How do we deal with
waiver from storm?
The stormwater, how do you deal with this?
So they want a waiver from the storm drainage requirements for industrial expansion of 1,600.
You mean the zoning board can change that?
No.
Yeah, why would we do that? I don't see any upside to doing that.
Nope.
So these people, they couldn't be here tonight. And so I said, well, let us know what you're doing. We'll kick it around. So do we want to schedule a public hearing?
I think you need more input from them or tell them what our concerns are. It's crazy.
Because at this point, from what we know,
if they put in the paperwork and put it into tomorrow.
Well, that's why they requested a.
But John, if they put the paperwork in tomorrow, the 21 days would run out before.
No, this is site plan review. That's an A&R. Site plan review is like...
When you say the setbacks, Kip, when was this building constructed originally? You know, what, did we have those setbacks in place then? Okay, I didn't, I'm just asking.
I mean, they even admitted existing non-conforming, and now they want to extend that, which normally we would say, no, this is when you...
Existing non-conforming might mean because they're on someone else's property, you know?
Side yard and rear yard.
See, it's over there.
And then the maximum lot coverage.
And that's a check to each side?
No, this is...
Seems like a non-starter.
Well, they should come in.
Well, Gorey just bought that.
Yeah, if they have something compelling to say.
All right, so do you want to talk to him?
Talk to who?
I think Renaissance Builders.
I can. What would you like me to relate to them?
They should come to our meeting.
This is highly irregular and it's...
He's just going further off the beam.
We have no...
The impervious surface thing, as if we really, I mean, we hate to go. And this is like asking the whole thing to be...
Right.
Yep.
Yeah, but just the parking alone, that would be enough to disqualify.
It's bananas, why?
Yeah, it's like...
And what is he going to do in that building? I still haven't really heard.
Electronics, Kip said.
I think they do electronics manufacturing.
Oh, is it Militech or whatever?
Even if they sought relief from the ZBA...
Militech was in there at one time.
As far as the setbacks...
That's the building that they painted.
I don't think the ZBA...
No, they were over the industrial park, right?
Could waive all park.
They were in both places for a while.
Well, you know, you let you cover the entire block, you don't have to park on the streets.
It sounds like they should buy it. If they bought the next one and merged it, then they might want...
That's bonkers. They should buy the land behind it and over here.
Well, yeah, but...
I mean, I think we also want to say...
It's only a tenth of an acre, can't we?
I think we would like to introduce this subject by saying we like our current businesses, we like them to grow here and hire more people and do the work. I mean, we like that, but this seems like really pushing...
There's some, concern, a lot of concerns, it's like,
Well, without a single compelling ask, you know?
This is me. Don't give it to me. Put it in the box, I'll come in and talk to her. Because I can't find it anywhere.
Oh, here, I'll give you a copy of mine.
And it should be...
You have mine?
No.
It's probably electronic version, too.
No.
All right, I got two other quick things.
I got it from Diana. I know Diana has it.
FERCOG came out with another one of these district local training assistant project requests. So if we want, remember we got $10,000 that helped pay for the tax rate and stuff? So they could do that on our behalf again if we're so inclined. So that might be something that I can talk to Sue and Diana about, and that was pretty useful. Is that okay if I explore that option?
Yes, please.
And the other is we need a representative to the Franklin Regional Planning Board from the Planning Board of the Municipality of Deerfield. So John Baronis had been on this, he kind of enjoyed it. And Mary thought she might...
I'm overcommitted.
Enjoy it.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Yep.
It's a good...
Two teenagers, blah, blah, blah. I'm overcommitted.
They meet, I'm trying to think if they meet monthly or bi-monthly, maybe every other month.
I think it's monthly.
It's every month.
Yeah, I think it's the third Thursday. And I'm going I'll go this month, obviously, but, you know.
They meet six times a year, they meet six times a year. And we have two representatives.
Oh, maybe I'm missing...
You're actually the select board, you're still listed as the select board's appointee.
I did go to quite a few of those.
Yeah, interesting.
And I brought a pillow with me.
Do you want to, do you want to be our planning board right now?
Oh, heck no. If you want me to go to a coal mine and rescue canaries, I'll do that for you, but no.
You're trying to sell it to other people, come on.
Put Max on it.
Max, we vote?
I don't know.
You're making a motion?
I'm not making a motion.
The other thing we can do is we can sign up and go, each of us go at a time. It doesn't have to be the same.
I mean, they like to have, because then they send you emails, they tell you what it is, they give you the agenda.
Well...
I go to some because of my other jobs, but I don't necessarily go to all of them, but I guess I could go to enough of them that I could kind of... I get the email already.
Well, and that's what I can commit to. I can go to enough of them, but like if their expectation is that I go to every single one of them, I can't live up to that expectation. If everybody's fine with me missing some, then I can go.
When I went, there was never a full house. There were always people missing.
As long as you understand that that's what I can do. that's what I'll do.
And I went to two of those meetings where they didn't even have it because there wasn't a quorum.
Okay, fine. As long as nobody thinks I'm 100%.
You won't get whipped.
Okay.
Yeah,
we'll like I said, I'll go to like 2 a year and then
all right,
maybe
fine.
If some, and if there's an issue, like sometimes they might have a special thing about marijuana bylaw. Couple of us might want.
Well, and every time I've gone, it's been really interesting. Yeah. I mean, I haven't had anything to say, and I wished I brought my knitting, but.
Hello.
I like knitting sounds better.
Yeah. As long as I can craft, I'll be fine.
Can you, do they have your name, but they don't have the rest, and they don't have a vote. So can we make out they want to vote? So I move that Ann Mary is our representative.
A second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? No. Abstaining.
Awesome. And they totally have my address, but that's okay.
All right. All right. And then we had some mail. And did you ever look at it?
No.
Nothing to report. So we have a...
Here. I'll look really quickly. And
sometimes there is something.
Something really interesting.
Maybe someone would have said something about it.
Oh.
Put my name on.
Oh, this is from Kevin Scarborough. Because they're really moving around.
Oh, okay. So the condominiums in Sugarloaf are moving along, and you know we had some check-ins before
thank you.
Our building commissioner would release some more properties, mm-hmm. and so we did that probably
well,
8 months
ago
or something.
Half. They got the second half.
Is this Snowberry Court?
Their sewer line, their water line, all that hooked up in the last month or so.
So our Kevin from our DPW says he's satisfied with the substantial completion of phases 2 and 3 roadways, drainage, sewer for Snowberry Circle and Greylock Lane. This approval encompasses all roads, drainage, sewer for the entire project known as condominiums. So now, usually, Mark Whiteman will come and ask me to, for us to release like the next set of, mm-hmm. there were 3 phases, I think. So we good with that? I'll look at the map again and see what it all, it was pretty specific. What, yeah, well, but this is what we kind of need to know.
I guess the road must go in because the road went in for both ends, and I know they've gone up the west side is all the way up to the top corner.
And then Greylock mm-hmm. is the
cross
one that crosses over.
Is that the one that crosses the middle?
Yeah, I mean,
yep.
That's the only two
so
roads
then,
here.
So then it's probably, I know they've gone up the east side, they've gone up, or southeast side, they've gone up halfway there. To the
okay, everybody, the other thing that's really important here is we have to promise that we have disclosed all our campaign finance activity. So, that's very ironic of them.
Just the ones that are running, or everybody?
Everybody.
If you
I don't
ran
understand
in
that.
The past year,
oh,
you have
you
to tell
this?
Them that you spent money on
I that. Just did. That's why I put it to you.
So we have a request for comment. I saw this South Deerfield DG Series LLC. Do we all remember what DG?
Yes,
no.
I do.
Mm-mm. What is
Dollar
it?
General.
Dollar General.
Oh, my goodness.
this is from the... Zoning Board of Appeals, there's an application from South Deerfield DG. The project proposes a development through the construction of a 9,300 square foot retail building with associated site improvements. A special permit is requested for the proposed retail use in the Commercial 2 District under the standards of Section 5300.
I have no idea what that
is. So they started the special permit process, I guess.
When?
This is dated December 11th. 2019.
Since our last meeting.
So I have a lot of comments. How do we, how should we go?
The building's twice the size it should be for that lot. That's my first comment. I don't know. Out loud, that's just what I'm thinking.
Yes, that's what we like to hear. Out loud.
And there's got to be an open meeting, got to be a planning, I mean, in a public hearing, right?
Right. So this is just our request for comments, like we send to them sometimes, they send it to us.
Who's that? The state selectman?
Zoning
Board of Appeals. Okay.
I clearly said that.
Sorry, I didn't hear it.
Oh. All right. So planning board.
Probably as a board shouldn't make any other comments other than saying that we're currently in litigation and that we'll deal
oh,
with.
Oh, you're right,
comes
Kip.
In front
that's.
Of us,
yeah.
There you go.
Be
why not?
But individually, we can speak what we want to say. Mm-hmm. And as a board, I kind of think that might be a good idea to go down.
Yeah.
So I wonder if
that's a good idea.
Did you see anything about a scheduled public hearing for this?
I haven't gotten that far.
Oh.
Hold on.
That would be very good.
Jesus. That's a lot of water.
So we are still in litigation, I guess. It's.
I don't think it's litigation, right?
No, I think
it's mediation. It's.
Yeah, exactly.
No, it's litigation. They sued us.
They sued us. Yeah, they did sue us.
Well, they did. I thought it was.
You got the notice.
Okay, we all got the notice.
A long time ago, but I thought it was mediation. I didn't think they pursued that.
I thought we were just starting over now and just going through the process.
Yeah, we're not being sued. They dropped that because we're mediating.
No.
You should.
No.
So it's still there if we don't.
We're trying to negotiate. We're mediating a settlement is what we're doing.
Right, so we're not going through the court system right now. We're paused in the court system and we're going through a mediation system.
Right, but if the two sides don't come together, the lawsuit is still right there.
Right, but it's not, right, okay.
Yeah.
It's not happening right now. It's paused.
Do you want to read that and see if anybody wants to comment on that one? Who's that from? That's from the zoning board also.
Eversource. Eversource James Ahern for an addition for one new antenna to the existing radio tower located at the Comtuck Communications site off Old Pine Nook Road in Deerfield. Said addition is in support of the grid modernization and distribution automation project in Deerfield, Shelburne, and Greenfield. Two radio antennas will be 9 foot 6 inches in length, attached to 119 foot level of the 120 foot tower. I don't think anybody will see it.
Whose tower is it?
You see that? It's up there. It's up next to the telephone.
It's Eversource.
It's in my backyard.
Yeah.
Yeah, but whose property? Like, I think Warner has
Warner Brothers
site, and we have the town has a site. Don't they?
AT&T has a site up there. There's three or four sites up there all in a row.
I know the town.
There's a site up there for Deerfield Academy.
I don't think the town has any land that the tower's on. I think the Warners own a piece of land, and then
did you rent it?
Sure, owns the other piece. I think it might be Eversource.
Then you don't have
Deerfield
to do
Academy
this.
Has
the
a
year
place
I ran,
place
I had to do
a
it.
Tower.
But I did it.
Deerfield Academy.
So if nobody ran,
never heard that
nobody has to do it.
We used to service their radios up there.
Okay, that's
when I ran.
That I do know.
I feel that myself. But nobody else has.
They put a wooden pole, wooden telephone pole up next to the building to take the place of the aluminum tower that almost fell down.
Like my friends who ran for, you know,
but there's at least half a dozen different people up there with their own towers and stuff.
Oh, I don't think there's a half a dozen towers up there. I almost think there's only two towers.
It's two towers, but I mean, there might be a lot of antennas off of the towers.
Right, exactly.
I disagree with that, but that's okay.
Well, it was last May when we all.
Yeah, it was last year. It wasn't this year.
Oh, this is the year ending. You got to do a year ending.
That's you.
Yeah.
Oh, that's me too then. Didn't we both run the same year?
Two of you?
Yeah.
I think we did.
You do one at the beginning, you do one after, and then you do one at the end of the year.
Okay. So my question is, I don't have to repeat the information.
Explain that they brought a lawsuit against the planning board after we denied the request for safety. Therefore, we should probably not comment at this time.
Yeah, there you go. You got it.
But I think they know. Well, that will be interesting if they start their site plan review public hearing soon. I guess they could do that prior to finishing us with us. So no, what do we have comments? It's okay?
I don't think that we, I don't
know. I think Kip's right. I don't think we should comment.
No comment.
But the Eversource one? No, yeah. No issue.
Especially those little antennas.
But no comment.
I was going to say, you see it from the ground.
You won't even as long see as they it. Meet the zoning.
Well, here we see no issue.
Do they have a fall zone for the antennas up there? Sounds like they're going to put up their own tower.
It's only 19 feet tall.
Anything else, Rachel?
Well, that's what I'm saying.
No.
What they do in most towns is they take in the tower's here, and if the tower falls over,
all those
and it hits
favor?
Anywhere.
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
I don't think they're proposing
next
to put
meeting,
a tower
six
up.
O'clock.
No, they're proposing putting